A very good evening, viewers. I, Dr. Rumi Ahmed, from Royal School of Law and Administration, the Assam Royal Gurbet University, welcome you all in this webinar. With a vision to offer nationally and internationally integrated opportunities to create global citizens, the Assam Royal Gurbet University has become the leading institute of higher education in India, and has recently declared rank one private university in Assam by C4 Education Board. Located on National Highway 37, Royal Gurbet University stands high with its virtues, excellence, and a humble contribution to the society at large. The campus is more than 27 acres of land and about 12 lakh square feet built up centrally air-conditioned area available for running various courses of Royal Gurbet University. With experienced faculty and world-class infrastructure and facilities, Royal Gurbet University is one of the finest universities of the country. Royal Gurbet University offers a unique educational experience that prepares the next generation of global citizens to live and make a difference in the world. With its talented and motivated student body and accomplished faculty, Royal Gurbet University is a leading educational hub in the Northeastern region. Royal Gurbet University started imparting law education under the name of the Royal School of Law Administration, and within a very short duration of time started various courses in law, including PhD in law, PG diploma in intellectual property rights, and PG diploma in cyber law and cyber crime, apart from BA LLB honors and masters in law. Today, I, on behalf of Royal School of Law and Administration, welcome you all in this webinar on Triple Talaq Beyond Political Bickerings, and hope that your many queries and doubts will be crystal clear after listening to our eminent guest speaker, Dr. Sangeeta Laha. Before that, before I introduce our guest speaker, I'd like to introduce with you Honorable Vice Chancellor of the Assam Royal Gurbet University, Professor Dr. S.P. Singh, sir. Professor Dr. S.P. Singh, sir, with having 28 years of academic and administrative experience, and was the former senior vice president, MIT Group, and vice chancellor, MIT University, Chhattisgarh. Sir has done his PhD from Lucknow University. Sir has also a background of management as well as geology, and sir has also done his law from Lucknow University. Sir has published various research articles in many national and international reputed journals. Now, I would like to request Honorable Vice Chancellor of Royal Gurbet University to say a few words and to start this webinar series. Sir, over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Rumi, other faculty members and seniors of Royal Gurbet University. Our eminent speaker for the day, Dr. Sangeeta Laha, my old colleague in MIT, and right now she's working there in Jharkhand. So, good evening to all of you. And it's very, very fortunate moment for all of us to interact on this webinar on a very, very relevant topic. I would say very burning topic for a very long time. And as it has been said, beyond political bickerings. So this is something, a unique topic altogether, and it is more of, I would say, woman empowerment, woman rights, than merely law which stopped triple talaq. So I think it's a very, very interesting topic, and I think Dr. Laha must be putting forward many such views and maybe experiences of the people and the law, which is basically come out from the requirements of the society. And maybe at times we see that each and every law which we read and which we practice and which we follow, that is basically evolved from the societal norms, then practices, then culture. So norms, practices, culture, in a way to control the society, I will not use the words, to manage the society well, to make society more, I would say, having some kind of rules and regulations so that we are not behaving like animals and we live like a social being, humans are basically social animals. So all those things about law, everybody knows about these issues about law. But then this topic is very, very pertinent. And I think I have read a lot about this topic. And in family law, whenever I used to read Hindu law and Muslim law, that used to be very, very favorite subject of mine. And still, I want to tell all the people here in the webinar that I'm pursuing my LLM, and I probably will be able to complete my LLM this year from a distance mode. And maybe in due course of time, I would love to do PhD in law also. But that is the way we teachers are. And as a lifelong learner, I would request each one of you that please keep on doing something new after every 5 year, 10 year. My target is every 10 years, I do something new, some new subject that has no relation with my direct relation with my old subject from geology, after 10 years management, after 10 years law, now after 10 years is going to be LLM and maybe PhD in due course of time. But basic purpose is not the degrees. Basic purpose is to understand things better and understand things with the viewpoint of law. And I think law is one of the most interesting subjects for me, at least. And I think all of you should read as much as you can read about law, because that helps you a lot in running your institution, in running your life, and counseling people otherwise. So I'm very, very eager to listen to Dr. Laha today, and I will be with you all for another 20-25 minutes. So I'll not be there for a long time in between Dr. Laha and the participants. So all the best to all of you, and all the best, Dr. Laha. I'm very, very eager to listen from you. And thank you very much for taking out time for the webinar. And we are really delighted. And we really are thankful to you. So over to you, Rumi. And I don't want to say more about this topic. Thank you. Your audio is off. Mic. Rumi, you can switch on your mic, please.
Dear viewers, let me introduce to you our honorable guest speaker for the today's webinar, that is Triple Talaq Beyond Political Bickerings. Dr. Sangeeta Laha has done her MA in Political Science. She has also done her MA in Marketing Law from Patna University. She has done her PhD in Law and Gender Justice from the University of Calcutta. Currently, she is pursuing postdoctoral program. And her topic for research is titled Democratic Decentralization and Women's Perspective Participation, a critical study with reference to Panchayati Raj system in India. She has published a book titled Women and Legal Profession in Reference to Indian Context. She is assistant professor in West Bengal National University of Juridical Sciences, Kolkata, Chanakya National Law University, Patna, and has worked in Amity Law School, Amity University, Lucknow, as professor and deputy director, where she was guiding PhD scholars apart from teaching PhD, postgraduate, and LLB students. Currently, she is an associate professor, law, and dean of faculty in National University of Study and Research in Law, Ranchi. She has presented and published several research papers and articles in journals of national and international review. Recently, her work is published in RMNL University Journal, which captioned The Journey from Marginal to Mainstream, the Oaths of Transgender in India, and another article published on depression captioned Stress, Stigma, and Sleep Loss during COVID-19 pandemic in Tehelka English Magazine. Ma'am has nowadays writing regularly in Tehelka Magazine. Thank you. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Rumi. Thank you, Dr. Singh, for giving me an opportunity and not only giving me an opportunity, but to have an interactive webinar with the Assam Royal Global University. Indeed, it is a great honor to me to come before you and to have this interactive session. Now, the topic of today is Triple Talaq Beyond Political Bickering. Why I have chosen this topic is Triple Talaq had been a matter of debate since long. Now, we do have the Triple Talaq law now, but in spite of having Triple Talaq law, what we find is in the eastern part of UP, after the law was enacted, even there has been a lot of cases of triple talaq after the enactment of the law. Does it mean to say that the law is not proactive? Does it mean to say that our society is not ready to accept the law? Does it mean to say that the society is not willing to accept the change? So these are some of the reasons which I'm going to discuss today in this topic today. Or does it mean that even after the Shahbano case, which still haunts in the minds of the Congress at that point of time, there has been a lot of political dialogues, gimmicks, a lot of controversies regarding this issue? Or is that mean that, is it also means that to ban instant divorce, that is instant talaq, has brought a mixed reaction in our country? Comparatively, if you find divorce in Hindu law is a civil offense, if you go with the Hindu Marriage Act, it is a civil offense. But so far, this law has been enacted. It has been criminalized. The offense of triple talaq has been criminalized. A man uttering this word talaq three times can be also jailed. So there has been a lot of debates, a lot of discussion on this particular issue. Now, what we find is Muslim marriage, unlike Hindu marriage, is in a nature of contract. What does contract mean? It is an offer and acceptance. Offer by the Muslim bridegroom, accepted by the Muslim bride through the verses read by the Quran. So once the offer and acceptance is complete, the nikah ceremony is done and the marriage is said to be complete. Now, in between, there's another more ritual. I don't want to go into details of the marriage, but the ritual is the dower, where the contract is accepted on the payment of the dower, which can be either in a prompt way or in a deferred manner, which is also known in Urdu word is meher. So these are some of the basic ingredients that make the Muslim marriage complete. So it is very different from the performance of marriage of the Hindus as per the Hindu Marriage Act of 1955. For Hindus, it is monogamy has been established a rule. So if there is a spouse living until and until the death of the spouse or on divorce, a Hindu man or a Hindu woman cannot solemnize the marriage. But that is not so in Muslim law. In Muslim marriage, they are permitted up to marry up to four. For a Hindu, for a Muslim man, he can marry up to four. But surprisingly, for the Muslim woman, she cannot marry. She has to remain with her shahar until she is divorced or until she dies. Now, if you go back to the British time, you will find that there has been not much of changes in the Muslim law. And Muslim law is completely based on the verses of Quran. So when the Quran is silent, there are other sources of law, of course. But generally, what we assume is it is all what the Muhammad has spoken out or what it has been written down in the verses of Quran. Now, during the British era, the first legislation that extended the statutory rights for the first time to the Muslim woman to give divorce to her husband was under the dissolution of Muslim Marriage Act 1939. And in that section 2, you will find that there are some clauses, some ingredients that has been inserted through which the Muslim wife has the right to give divorce, which has been recognized as a statutory right. Otherwise, in her personal law, she does not have the right to give divorce compared to her husband who has the absolute right to give divorce to his wife through the mode of talaq. So that is the distinguishing point between the two personal laws of Hindu and Muslim. Not only that, there's a distinguishing point between a Muslim man and that of a Muslim woman. Now, there are two broad categories under which divorce or talaq and a Muslim law can be divided. What is that? First is extrajudicial divorce or talaq under Muslim law. And second is judicial divorce or talaq under statutory law. Now, what is this extrajudicial divorce? extrajudicial divorce is a divorce which depends upon the husband or wife or between both of them under a mutual agreement. And there are different rights which have been provided to the wife and husband. Generally, rights to give divorce are given to husband only. But to a wife, it is in a very lower pedestal, where the right of divorce is delegated by the husband to the wife under an agreement. So before the nikah ceremony is performed, this delegation of rights takes place. Otherwise, in extrajudicial divorce, the Muslim wife absolutely has no right to divorce her husband. Now, extrajudicial divorce is again divided into several parts. What it is? By the husband, it is talaq al-sanad and talaq al-biddat, ila and zihar. By wife, it is talaq al-taibis. And just now I told you what is talaq al-taibis. It is a delegated form of divorce, or lien and khulla. Now, again, by the wife, it can also be done as by a mutual agreement, that is mubarak. But this mutual agreement, that is mubarak, is different what we find is divorced by mutual consent under section 13B of the Hindu Marriage Act. So there is a statutory recognition for the Hindu husband or the Hindu wife to file jointly or amicably between both the parties to seek divorce under mutual consent. But here it is different. Now, what is talaq al-sanad, which is also known as talaq al-razi in Urdu words? Talaq al-sanad is one of the best form of divorce. Why it is the best form? Because it is a revocable form of divorce, and it is recognized both by the Sunnites and by the Shias. Now, in Muslims, there are two majority groups, the Sunnites, which is a very dominant population in India. Indian population, 90.99% are dominated by the Sunnites. We have less of Shia population in India. And that is one of the reasons why talaq, form of extrajudicial divorce, is recognized among the Muslim population in India. So this talaq al-sanad again has got two forms of mode. What it is? It is Ahsan form of divorce or talaq, which is the most proper form of repudiation of marriage. And the reasons are twofold. One, it is there is a possibility of revoking the pronouncement before the expiry of the iddat period. And secondly, the word talaq are to be uttered only once, and they are not to be repeated. So this is one Ahsan form of talaq. Yeah, in this case of mohr, that is the single pronouncement of talaq, is done during the period of tuhar. Now, what is this meaning of tuhar? This is the period where the Muslim husband can consummate or may have cohabitation between his spouse. And this is the period of purity, that is, the Muslim woman is not subjected to menstruation during this period of time. So this period of purity is where the Muslim man can pronounce talaq by a single pronouncement. And after the single pronouncement of talaq in the Ahsan modus, the Muslim woman is bound to observe the period of iddah. What is this iddah? The iddah is the period of 3 monthly courses or 3 lunar eclipses. That is a period of 90 days. So, in this period, the Muslim woman has to perform, and there is no such revocation by the talaq, by the husband, then in that case, the talaq is said to be final. So how can revocation take place? That is either by express or implied actions. And in implied action is the husband foregoes the wife comes back to the conjugal life once again. So once he comes back to the conjugal life, it means that the talaq has been revoked through consummation, and divorce does not take place. So that's one form of talaq we have. That is the Ahsan form of talaq. The second form of talaq we have is the Hasan form of talaq. This is also proper and approved form of talaq. And the pronouncement of talaq is in between the three successive tours. And just now I made you realize what tour is. So it is in the three successive period of purity that the pronouncement of talaq takes place. That is the distinguishing point between ahsan form of talaq and the hasan form of talaq. Now this is one type of talaq, which is the best form of talaq, and it is approved by Prophet Muhammad himself. The most controversial part of the topic is where I'm now coming into is the talaq al-biddat, which is biddah, which is also known as talaq al-bayn. Now this is the form, pronouncement of talaq, which has been in controversy through three decades. Why biddah? Because this is a disapproved form of divorce. Even Prophet Muhammad was not much in favor of talaq al-biddah. Now, why this talaq al-biddah came into force then? If it is not in the injunctions of Quran, then what is the question might come in your mind is, then why this talaq al-biddah or the worst form of talaq, that is talaq, has been coming as a customary form? Some of the reasons that hit my mind was in earlier period when the Muslim man or the Arabs who had used to come out of the Muslim world came to Syria for a trade purpose, could not go back and meet his spouse, and they came in contact with several beautiful Syrian women and wanted to get married. They could not marry until and unless that Syrian beauty told him or was very pressurized him that he should talaq his first wife. So this practice, that is talaq al-biddah, through three times, actually came in the latter part of the Muhammadan period, after the death of the Prophet Muhammad, when these Arabs started minting money and wanted to marry the beauties when they came across the world. So that is how this disapproved form of divorce started continuing, and it slowly became very popular. Now, a peculiar feature, why we say it is a disapproved form and it is the worst form of divorce in Muslim law is, the moment the talaq is pronounced, it becomes effective as soon as the words are pronounced. So there remains no possibility of reconciliation between the parties, thereby making the divorce irrevocable. And this practice, this pronouncement, is mostly recognized by the Sunni Muslims, but it is not recognized by the Shia Muslims. So talaq al-biddat, pronounced in single declaration or by triple declaration, makes the divorce final. Now, the procedure, I did not go into detail because by now you must have understood the triple declaration, that is the three pronouncement, I divorce thee, that is talaq, you must have seen in many movies, in one sentence makes the talaq final or the divorce final. Now, the other two modes are ila and zihar. I'm not going much into details of that because they are not much practiced in among the Muslim populations in India. For the Muslim wife, again, you have divorce through Mubara, which I have just now said it. It's a delegated, it's a joint agreement between both the parties. The Muslim woman can also divorce through a statutory, that is through a statute, that is through a dissolution of Muslim Marriage Act, 1939. So these are the various forms of divorce that is prevalent in Muslim law. Now, this divorce became very controversial. Why it became controversial? When we started making use of the IT, the technology part, when we started using mobiles, divorce was given either through SMS. Divorce was given through electronic means. Divorce was given through WhatsApp. And more we found what we witnessed is that talaq was becoming very, very common. Earlier, as far as talaq al-biddat is concerned, it doesn't require the presence of the wife. The only requirement, the mandatory requirement is it can be pronounced through a through some witness or through some mode, and it should be communicated to the wife. That is the one of the requirements. Other than this, the presence of wife is not required, although they can pronounce it under three pronouncement. Now this talaq al-biddat became so controversial, and you jolly well imagine the agony of the Muslim women who had to shed their tears for no means. If they didn't bring dowry, the husband could pronounce talaq. If she didn't give birth to a male child, because male child is very much it's a sort of an obligation for the woman to birth to a Muslim boy, because it is he who actually inherits the most of the property, number one. It is he who carries the family lineage. So like Muslim Hindu community, Muslim community also earns for a Muslim male child. So if there is no birth of a boy in the couple, then also the Muslim husband can, with a pretext, can bring a second wife, can bring a third wife, can bring a fourth wife. So you can jolly well imagine the apathy, the pathetic condition that the Muslim woman may have to bear, but she cannot remarry at any cost. So there's a lot of, you know, to me, apparently, I find there's a lot of disharmony, discrimination, not only among the Muslim man and the Hindu man, because Hindu man can only marry up to one, but also among the Muslim woman and Hindu woman. A Hindu woman can straight away file a case of divorce under cruelty, can straight away file a case of desertion under Hindu Marriage Act, can straight away file a case stating that the husband is mentally abnormal. So she has got 9 conditions to file her case against her husband, but the Muslim woman could not enjoy such a right. So these were some of the grievances that was prevailing among the Muslim community, that the Muslim women were not enjoying those rights which the Hindu woman was enjoying. And coupled with that is the talaq through SMS, through WhatsApp, through electronic media, through words. Any point of time, the Muslim man would pronounce the talaq. Although the Supreme Court in Shamim Ara's case has rightly pointed out that talaq cannot be pronounced at whims and fancy. But who would bother for the Supreme Court case? Finally, this irrevocable form of talaq was once again challenged in the Honorable Supreme Court in a case of Shaira Bano versus Union of India. So this is one of the latest controversial judgment for empowerment of Muslim women, a judgment for gender justice, a judgment asking where the Muslim women are asking now, this is high time, it is 3 decades of Indian independence, why are we still facing such a, why we are still being discriminated? So for the first time, this is not for the first time, I'm sorry, I take back my words. In Shabano's case also, triple talaq was also questioned. But in Shabano's case, her husband, who was happened to be a very cunning lawyer and had a very good practice, he twisted his case and did not want to give maintenance to the Shabano. He divorced this woman after 40 years of marriage, at the age, practically at the age of 60, when she was already having grown-up children. So just imagine, where will that woman go if at an old age she's abandoned by her husband, and such a woman who has got no financial means to carry on the day-to-day activity. So in Shabano's case also, we find that the triple talaq was challenged because this lawyer husband of hers brought the second woman who was very young, and therefore used that biddat form of talaq, and instantly the talaq became irrevocable. So she also questioned, but his Justice Chandrachud did not go greatly into the details of triple talaq, but made it mandatory that despite the dower amount, I just now told you half an hour before that mehar amount is one of the mandatory requirements in a nikah ceremony. So he distinguished that mehar amount is different. It is a gift to the Muslim woman, but maintenance is a duty of every husband to pay to the Muslim women on divorce. And therefore, he brought Section 125 of the CRPC. And to quote Section 125 once again, it includes, wife includes also divorced wife until she remarried. So in Shabanu's case, the maintenance amount, the maintenance was given by the Supreme Court, and that was the turning point in, again, in this Muslim personal law, because we have, for the first time, the Congress that time was the ruling party in our country, and the Rajiv Gandhi government with the Muslim Protection on Rights on Divorce Act, just after the Shabanu case. Now, Section 5 of that case is very tricky. Now, whenever a legislation comes, it must be having and the ulterior motive of the ruling party. To woo the sentiments, Rajiv Gandhi came out with this act. But if you see Section 5 of that Muslim Protection on Rights of Divorce Act, it says that it is the option or the Muslim woman can seek an option and must seek the consent of the husband if she wants to file a case of maintenance under Section 125 to 127 of the CRPC. Now, as you know, the amount of maintenance in a 125 CRPC has now been made unlimited. Earlier it was 500, thereafter it was increased to 1500, thereafter it was increased to 5000, and now it is unlimited. Now tell me, which Muslim husband who wants to divorce his wife will give the consent to file an application under Section 125 of the CRPC? So this is why the Congress had cunningly drafted this case only to woo the orthodox sentiments of the Muslim population in India. But in Shaira Banu's cases, once again, we find that this woman, she's a woman, she was a student of sociology. She filed the case before the apex court. Why she filed the case before the apex court? Because her husband, she got married, and after a few years of her marriage, her husband pronounced divorce on the pretext that she doesn't want to come back from her parents' home. And now, she was a victim. She was 38 years old, 11 years of a marriage from Uttarakhand. She moved before the Supreme Court, challenging the Islamic practices of triple talaq, number one. Number two, polygamy. As just now I told you, they can marry up to four. Number three, nikah halala. Now, this is a very interesting thing. First, triple talaq. By now, we know what triple talaq is. We also know what polygamy is. It is restricted up to four wives. But what is this nikah halala? Now, this is another form which the Muslim woman has to practice once the divorce is given by a husband, if she wants to remarry her former husband or if the former husband wants to remarry her. Now, what is this nikah halala? Nikah halala is, it is often found that the Muslim man divorces his wife, maybe out of provocation, maybe out of anger, maybe out of greed. So there may be a variety of reasons why he has pronounced divorce. Maybe he wants to marry for the second time. So there may be 1001 reasons, excuses, why he has given divorce to her. Now, after some time, let's say after 3 or 4 weeks, he repents. And he again goes to that divorced wife. Meantime, she's in that iddah period. Iddah period, just now I told you, 3 months or until her delivery of a child, if she's carrying. Now, what he does is, he tells her that she wants to remarry her again. Therefore, in Muslim law or in Muslim practices, this ex-wife now again has to remarry some other person, some other Muslim woman, consummate the marriage with the second man in her life, take divorce from her, and then remarry. Now, don't you think it's the self-respect of the Muslim woman that is questioned, that is being questioned here? In several instances, Muslim man tells her ex-wife to remarry his friend. And the agreement between him and his friend is, once he remarries her, after giving some amount of money, let's say after 3 days, that friend consummates the marriage and again utters the word talaq. Now, is that Muslim woman a shuttlecock between the first husband and the second husband? In any case, if the second husband doesn't divorce her, then there is no pretext of marrying the first husband. Or if the marriage, second marriage is not consummated, in any case, she cannot go back to the first husband. So there has been a lot of discriminatory practices which the Muslim woman had to suffer before she could again remarry. And this performance, that is to remarry the second man in order to marry the first one, this performance is known as nikah halala. And this, what we find, is the point of dispute which was again challenged by this Shaira Bano, along with many petitions, including NGOs who had itself, who was, they were themselves agitating before the Supreme Court, asking for the constitutional validity of this triple talaq. Isn't it not violative of Article 14 of the Constitution of India? So numerous petitions were challenged at the same, on the same issue. And what the Supreme Court, Honorable Supreme Court did it, it clubbed all the petitions together, and in one petition they started hearing the matter. So various NGOs at that point of time, even the ruling government, was supporting the cause. Now halala is the root, is one of the root causes of discrimination, and the word halal in Urdu, if translated, it means permissible and therefore lawful. So if a Muslim woman has been, had that nikah halal, agar uska halal ho gaya hai, then only she can be permitted to remarry the first one. So this dicta of the Muslim man who has the liberty to divorce at any point of time through talaq, who has the liberty to remarry the same woman twice, is not permissible neither in Hindu law nor permissible even to the Muslim woman. So it can also be seen that he's again divorcing that woman for the second time. Again, he's asking her to marry the third man. So this is how the practice has been going on. So this is what was the point of agitation before the Supreme Court. So the two issues that was introduced, the point of debate in this case, was the validity of the triple talaq, as just now I told you, is it violative of Article 14 of the Constitution of India? And number two is whether triple talaq is an essential religious practice. If it is not an essential religious practice, if it has been made a customary, then it is violative of Article 14, 16, 21, Article 19 of the Constitution of India. Now, the judgment was heard finally from the Allahabad High Court. The judgment went to the Supreme Court. And on August 22, 2017, so just 3 years, we are in 2020, 3 years before, the judgment was passed in the majority of 3-5 majority, holding the practice of triple talaq unconstitutional. And the beauty of this judgment was, it was a constitutional bench of 5 judges, and all the 5 judges were from different religions, from a different background. That was the beauty of this judgment. The majority judgment was written by Justice Nariman, who himself, on behalf of Justice Lalit and Justice Joseph. So there was a Christian judge, there was a Parsi judge, there was a Hindu judge, there was a Muslim judge, concurred by the majority opinion, Chief Justice Kehar for himself, and on behalf of Justice Nazir, wrote the minority judgment. So the judgment was in between 3-5, 2. And there is a very, you know, thin line of distinction between the 3 judges and that of the 2 judges. But after a lengthy discussion, all the judges came to the conclusion that triple talaq is not an essential religious practice under Islamic law. And they quoted Article 25 of the Constitution, which says that that the state cannot take away the essential religious practice of a person. So if triple talaq is not an essential religious practice, the state can very well take away. Therefore, if a practice which is arbitrary, triple talaq, they said it is constitutional, it is arbitrary, it is not conforming to the essential religious practice, then it is hit by the exception laid down under Article 25. And therefore, the whole issue was whether or not the practice is an essential religious practice of Islam or not. So the judges went back to the injunctions of Quran, and nowhere in the Quranic injunction this triple talaq has been mentioned. Rather, the Prophet Muhammad has, in fact, he was not in favor of talaq, and he said this mode of giving talaq, though it is this is a very evil word, it can only be used in the last resort. So, but what we find is that Muslim women were actually using as a weapon in their hands, and were trying and were becoming powerful, and they were giving talaq at any point of time in whims and fancies. So the court came to the view in the sense that the triple form of talaq, which has been practiced by the Hanafi school, is considered to be sinful in Quran. Second, triple talaq is against the basic tenets of Quran, and whatever is against the tenets of Quran is contrary to the Sharia. Therefore, it is bad in theology and it cannot be said to be good in law. So they quoted again from the Shamim Ara case that this practice is bad in theology. The philosophy is actually very bad. And therefore, this law, this practice cannot be said to be good in law. We have learned in family law that customary law can only be accepted if it is for a longer period of time, if it is not opposed to public policy, and if it is taken by the general masses, that it has an acceptance of the same. Here what we find is triple talaq has never been accepted by the Muslim women. Rather, they have been forced into going into divorce. And very well, you and I know that what is the stigma of a divorcee woman, let it be in Christianity, let it be for Christian woman, or for Parsi woman, or for Hindu woman, or for Muslim woman even today. Because a divorcee woman is taken to be a very, she's taken to be a very careful, carefree woman. I mean, she's taken very lightly. So you can jolly well imagine the apathic condition, the emotional, the trauma that such a woman faces. And Article 25 carries the right of every person to practice and propagate any religion of choice, but it is restricted in the context of the following exceptions. And there are four exceptions. One, public order. Two, health. Third, morality. And fourth is other provisions and part three of the Constitution. And what the judges came to the conclusion was, this is in violation of part three of the Constitution. And part three of the Constitution deals with fundamental rights. So logically, it was proved that it is in violation of the fundamental rights of equality, since again, it is against the right of women, and as they have no say in the declaration of divorce, unlike in any other religion. So Justice Nariman and Justice Lalit jointly held that the impure practice is a tool by which the marital tie can be broken on the whims of the Muslim husband, without any attempt of reconciliation. In Bidda, once the talaq is pronounced, it is irrevocable. So there's no point of reconciliation. And this form of talaq, therefore, is in violation of Article 14 and liable to be struck down by the courts. So this is the beauty of the judgment of the constitutional bench that came back in 2017. The minority bench justified their stance on the ground that the practice is followed by a large population of people in our country. Now, this practice has a sanction of religious denomination, and because it is followed by the overwhelming majority of the Muslim population, the said practice is declared to be constitutional as an essential religious practice. However, Justice Kehar pointed out that as far as exceptions mentioned in Article 25 subclause 1 of the Constitution is concerned, he is of the opinion that the impugned practice is not violative, and any of the exceptions in Sharia or Muslim personal law is not based on any state legislative action. But however, the majority of the bench, the opinion of the majority of the bench prevailed, and triple talaq is now banned, and this practice has been made as has been made unconstitutional, and therefore the constitutional bench again urged the state, that is the government, to bring out the legislation. So this was the attempt of the petition filed by Shaira Banu, Ishrat Jahan, Afreen Rehman, Gulshan Parveen to bring successful justice to many unheard voices of India. Now, in the coming months, after the Supreme Court judgment is now, you know, we have a lot of reactions in the society. One of the reactions which I could get during my research of this topic in this webinar was from the All India Muslim Personal Law Board that pushed the ban. They particularly said that the government was actually setting the stage for a uniform civil court. So the ruling government was actually coming out, was voting with the idea that we must have a uniform civil court. And therefore AIMPLB said that this is how they were pushing forward the ban of triple talaq, which is only recognized by the Sunni population, but didn't have the support of the Shia Muslims. Therefore, they opposed the contention, saying that any change in the triple talaq would be anti-Islamic. And Supreme Court in its various judgment has, though the Supreme Court in various judgment has upheld the personal law. So they kept on saying that is it is un-Islamic in nature. And they argued that the community cannot be rewritten in the name of a social reform. The court cannot supplant its own interpretation over the scriptures. So scriptures must have told about triple talaq, and the court is not the authority to overrule it. So this was the stand of the All India Muslim Personal Law Board. But the Muslim woman, one of the Muslim women, Shagufta, she wrote to Prime Minister Modi urging him to ban the triple talaq. After she was also, I mean, after the Supreme Court judgment, she was abandoned by her husband. And we find even after the Supreme Court judgment, there has not been a ban of triple talaq. So ultimately, what the ruling party did was, and there's again, I can quote you, the abolition of triple talaq al-bidat, where one of the prominent women campaigns led by Haseena Khan in Beba Collective, who is the grassroots organization of demanding equality for Muslim women, but she demanded that there has to be an abolition of talaq al-bidat, that is the worst form of talaq, and therefore she welcomed the court ruling which invalidated the triple talaq. So what we find, there has been a mixed reaction. All India Muslim Personal Law Board, comprising of Muslim Orthodox men, are trying that Supreme Court cannot interfere between in the scriptures of Quran, whereas the progressive Muslim women and many Muslim women who have been abandoned by the Muslim women, they welcome the Supreme Court decision. Now we come to even when we find that after Supreme Court decision, there has been a lot of cases both in UP and Bihar, that as I told you, through text, through SMS, through WhatsApp, which is again a new form of giving divorce, and very easily because he can communicate to his wife, is what we must now know is what is the triple talaq law. Now, triple talaq law, which is popularly known as the Muslim Women Protection of Rights on Marriage Bill 2019, was passed by the Indian Parliament just last year, just 1 year before, on July 30th, 2019, to make triple talaq a criminal offense. So how would the triple talaq, this action can be curbed? They passed an act which made a triple talaq a criminal offense. Now in the Rajya Sabha passed the bill with 99 votes in its favor and 84 against it. The triple talaq law makes the instant triple talaq a criminal offense and provides for a jail term of 3 years for a Muslim man who commits this crime. And this makes the triple talaq a cognizable and non-bailable offense. And as one of our present law minister, to quote our law minister, he replaced the ordinance promulgated on February 21, 2019, and it was now, this bill has now been made into a triple talaq act, which is just now I said the Muslim marriage protection of rights on marriage act 2019. It number one, the first point is it makes the triple talaq void and illegal. Number two, it makes punishment for the pronouncement of triple talaq. Number three, it talks about the custody of children. That is, a married Muslim woman shall be entitled to take the custody of her minor children in the event of pronouncement of talaq by husband in such manner as may be determined by the magistrate. Since this is some of the unique features of the talaq, the Muslim woman can file for custody or for maintenance under this act, which has also been recognized under the Muslim Protection on Rights of Divorce Act way back after the Shah Bano case. She can also file a case of maintenance under section 125 to 127 CRPC before the magistrate concerned. She can also file for the custody of her children which is also one of her rights after the Triple Talaq Act. And it is now for the magistrate to decide to have a summary proceeding and to give punishment to the so-called husband if he has used the worst form of divorce, that is triple talaq. Now, even despite the act come into being last year, that is 1 year before, what we find that it has still not been very active in that way. Why? Because I'm building up this argument before coming for this webinar, I saw that there has still been 26 cases that has been registered in Meerut itself, followed by Sharanpur district, where 17 and 10 police cases have already been registered against the Muslim husband who have uttered the word talaq. Then there has been FIRs against the husband that has been registered, which again shows whether the implementation of Muslim Women Protection of Rights on Marriage Act 2019 has been justified or whether it has been properly implemented or not. So altogether, of course, I could not get the latest statistics, but there has been 2016 FIRs that has been filed only in the state of UP, and Uttar Pradesh has the highest number of FIRs being registered, especially the eastern part of UP. So that has been one of the main reasons why the ruling government has come out with this act. That has been one of the main reasons why it has been made a criminal offense of triple talaq, because most of the triple talaq are being pronounced because of dowry, because of property, because of dispute between both the parties, because of domestic violence, etc., etc. So this also ensures, in a way, it has to also be ensured by the government for the effective implementation of the act. It has also to be ensured, the government must also ensure, not only in letter but also in spirit, that justice is to be given to the Muslim women, and that such culprits should be arrested. And therefore, just should not only be by letters, it should be also be in spirit. So this is what I could get a little bit. I could give my views on the topic, on the triple talaq, whether it is a political bickering or not. Certainly to me, being a woman, I feel the ruling government has done a wonderful job. The Supreme Court, the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court has stood this test of time, and it has been a long, long process of the agony of Muslim women. Think the number of gruesome offenses of domestic violence. Think about the tears that has come out from her eyes on several nights when she must have been beaten by her husband. And therefore, as a professor of law, I find that this act has justified, and there has been such a long decade of struggle only to bring this act, just not to discriminate among Muslim man and that of a Muslim woman. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity to give my views.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sangeeta Laha, ma'am, for such an enlightening session. I guess you have covered everything, the difference between the two talaq. And of course, it's talaq and divorce. You know, I remember those days when I also used to take the family law classes, and students used to ask the question that when I asked that, what do you mean by talaq? Then they randomly said, ma'am, jo Hindu law mein divorce hota hai, that is the divorce in Muslim law. But now I you have clarified that talaq is not only the divorce in among the Muslims. This is the univocal, you know, this is only the power given to the Muslim husband only. No Muslim woman can pronounce talaq. So this is the only power given to the Muslim husband only. Thank you so much, ma'am, for such a wonderful session. You have covered many case laws, and now we have to see. We hope that this new cases will come, and how this though the Supreme Court has pronounced this triple talaq as an unconstitutional. So the time will see that how this judgment. Right, how this law will be implemented and effective to bring the gender justice to the women in India. Thank you, ma'am. Now I'll take some questions. There are a lot many questions coming from our viewers. I'll be taking 2-3 questions, ma'am.
I'm ready to answer.
Yeah,
you gave me the time, and I completed, I think, by 55 minutes. So 5
yeah,
minutes.
Yeah, yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. So, ma'am, there's a listener from Delhi. He asked that, do you think triple talaq and nikah halala are social evils? What's your
Yes, to my understanding, and whatever I've read about law, is yes, it is a social evil. No, and why it is a social evil? It is a discriminatory practice. And had it not been a discriminatory practice, the Supreme Court would not have banned the triple talaq. Neither the government would have come up with such a law. So it is a social evil, to my understanding.
The next question, there's a question from our RGU faculty. And his question is, he says that there's a very interesting session. And he wanted to know that this, whether the ban on triple talaq is a step closer to the a grand vision of BJP to implement the Uniform Civil Code. So this is his question, ma'am.
I do not think it is an invasion for Uniform Civil Code. I cannot go into the negative aspect of that. To me, it has been a progressive legislation. And this legislation was required way back. We had independence in 1947. From 1947 to 2020 to 2019, it took a long time for the Muslim women to come out to speak for themselves. So it is not politically motivated. To me, it has been a progressive piece of legislation, at least the first step to stop the misuse of the triple talaq, the arbitrary misuse of triple talaq. So I do not agree that this is a step for Uniform Civil Code. Not at all. Because the state cannot override any personal law. So,
Another question comes from our student, from our law student from RGU. And she is asking, the law states that maintenance will be provided after divorce. If the husband is imprisoned, will the government truly be able to support the wife and children, especially in cases wherein the wife is economically dependent on the husband?
Yeah, that is a part of controversy that has been raised by many Muslim women also. They want to be empowered. But criminalizing triple talaq will also put them in a much more disadvantaged position. So if the husband is put into imprisonment, and that too for 3 years, the question of getting maintenance for her children also becomes very, very difficult, number one. Number two is that once the Muslim man is imprisoned, if he's in government service, obviously he's suspended. You know, that's the norm in government service. And if he's suspended, it is very difficult again for the Muslim woman to get maintenance from him. But in another way, until and unless the law cannot be made harsh, you cannot also stop some cunning Muslim man from pronouncing divorce. So there are the plus points. There are also some negative points of this law. But then the constitutionality of this law was again challenged in the Supreme Court, but Supreme Court did not find it unconstitutional. So the law is, as it stands, is the law what has been given by the present government.
Okay, our fourth question is, ma'am, that the pronouncement of talaq, again, if the question is from our student, the pronouncement of talaq thrice is to be done at one sitting or uttering the word talaq at three different intervals or through three different modes, it may be cause, face to face, etc., would also amount to
talaq. Can I get the questions once again, please?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
The pronouncement of talaq thrice is to be done at one sitting or uttering the word talaq at three different intervals or through three different modes would also amount to triple talaq?
Yeah, there are no, there is no, triple talaq is either pronounced one talaq, it becomes irrevocable, or it is pronounced as talaq, 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 it becomes irrevocable. What the participant is saying, but talaq in different intervals, in different tours, is not triple talaq. It is ahsan form of talaq or hasan form of talaq. As I told you, it is talaq al-sanad, which gives the opportunity to the man to reconcile his action. But in the triple talaq, there is no opportunity for reconciliation. Once pronounced, it becomes final. So it is an irrevocable form of talaq. And this is very common among the Muslim majority in India. It has been banned by Pakistan, by Bangladesh, by many Muslim countries. But India, surprisingly, had not banned this triple form. It is only in last year that this triple talaq could be banned, or it could be made illegal.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I'd like to ask our Vice Chancellor, sir, if he wanted to ask anything or any comment made by. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. So that's, we come to an end. We exactly, we finished within our time, ma'am. Thank you so much for that. And I hope that this social problem, how this Supreme Court judgment, how this bill will be enforced in our society, of course, that we will see. And time to time, we have to make this type of discussions, that mere passing a law is not enough. Afterwards, how that law is implemented, whether that proper awareness or that like sensitization has been made to the women folk, which is the community, which is a minority. Women itself is a minority community, again, Muslim community, where lack of education is prevalent in India. So time will see how this triple talaq, which has been pronounced unconstitutional in India, how this can be enforced in India. So thank you so much, ma'am, for such
thank
a
great
session. And we hope that you will come to the Royal Global University personally and give this type of deliberation and this kind of academic discussions in future. We will also make with you, do with you. And thank you so much. And that's how...
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. La.
Thank you, sir, for being in the webinar all along. And thank you, Dr. Rumi. And thank you to Assam Royal Global University for giving me such a wonderful opportunity for such a lovely evening and such a lovely webinar. Thank you very much, sir. God bless all of you.
I'd like to thank Honorable Jason, sir, Academic Chairperson, Dr. Olaf Kumar Burhagohai, all the technical staff and non-technical